going to start with our pest of the week. And Brian, our pest of the week this week is our, every year we don't necessarily see them like this, but we see the damage coming from these guys.
Moles and gophers. I think anybody that has a yard or has a garden or, you know, in the, you know, that's out there, we'll come across moles or gophers, and they're a challenge.
Well, and sometimes it seems like they're gone, we're doing fine, and then all of a sudden, bang, here's some damage from one of them.
Just when you think you got them under control.
Just when you think you've moved past that.
They bring you right back down to reality.
Right, so moles and gophers here. We got gophers over here on the side. Like, I think when we were talking earlier, you're saying, we're never going to see either of these for the most part.
Thank goodness. I mean, you'll see some every now and then. You'll see a cat bring one up or things. But for the most part, they're going to stay under the ground where they're feeding.
That's where they want to be.
That's right. So, yeah, you've got moles and gophers, pocket gophers to be specifically. Gophers eat grain and grass is kind of what I like to say. Moles eat meat. So there are two different animals, two different critters. The control's different. They look different. Their damage is different. Right. So that's one thing we've got to do up front is to figure out which one we have. One of the tricks is we may have both of them. So they may be running interchangeably. But we've just got to kind of figure that out, and then we can kind of go from there.
You know, the correct diagnosis, I know we've had people that will say, well, the moles are destroying my plants. Well, not necessarily. It might not be the moles. It's likely the gophers that are.
That's correct. Since they're eating grain and grass and roots, that's what they're eating. They'll eat a little bit of insects, but for the most part, those gophers are going to be eating plants.
Right. Well, and a difference between the critters here, you'll notice the mole, those hands are built for digging. Those are big digging paws. They let them dig those tunnels and move around the yard. And that little snap, I mean, it just seems like a custom built for digging.
It does, and I mean that hand, that arm takes up. It's bigger, almost as big as his head.
Oh,
so
really?
I mean, they're rolling through. Size of these guys, the gopher is kind of a small cat. So he's a big fella. She's a big fella. And the mole's going to be smaller. He's going to be more size of your hand. So maybe a quarter of the size of the gopher. But again, you won't hardly ever see the critters themselves. So it's the damage that we see. So let's go to the next one.
Yeah, kind of getting damage.
Yep. So this one is a gopher mound, a pocket gopher mound. So what's happened, his tunnel is a little deeper in the soil.
Right.
So he's pushing that dirt up. Tighter soils, the more pockets of dirt you'll have.
Oh.
The looser soils, they don't have to push it up as much. They can push it around the tunnels. So as they're digging, they can either push it aside or push it up out of the ground. And that's what we're getting here on the mound for that gopher.
I know sometimes now, just driving down the highway, maybe in a schoolyard or something, you'll see 15, 20 of these holes, I mean, they're pretty prevalent.
Yeah. So that may be tighter soil. That soil may be tighter,
and
they're having to push it up quicker.
Right.
So that particular one is a gopher. So let's go. You want the key? Gopher key.
Gopher key. That's a sure sign. You can tell if you see their keys. You know, if they left their keys outside the tunnel,
then they're there.
You know it's
then
a
there.
Gopher.
But
that's
the
just
size
there for scale.
The size may vary. It may vary from 6 to 8 inches in across to 2 feet. So it all really depends.
So identification, this is a gopher.
Correct.
And then this is a mole.
So this is a mole. The moles, you won't see pockets of dirt. You'll see the tunnels where they've lifted that up. They don't have to push that dirt up because that tunnel's right on that surface.
Right.
So you'll see that enlarged tunnel pretty much net-like all throughout our yard, just where it's raised up, and they're traveling as a highway right underneath that ground, underneath that surface.
Yeah, and maybe not as noticeable if you've got grass. You may not notice it in the grass, and maybe like you're mowing the yard and you feel it rather than see it with your eyes.
Or you see some yellowing in stripes, and you get a little closer inspection, that yellowing is because they lifted that grass up and it's drying out. That first inch or two soil dries out, so you may see yellowing there. Or you trip and fall because of that tunnel, or you twist your ankle, that's more likely because of that mole tunnel. So again, moles right below the surface, you see the tunnel.
Right.
Gophers, you see pockets of dirt.
Right. Now we call them pocket gophers. They're called pocket gophers because essentially they've got these little pockets beside their cheeks. So when they're out digging for food, trying to find the roots, they can actually store some food in there and take it back with them.
Take it back to their babies, or save it for later or whatever.
Yeah, so that's the reason pocket gopher is for those pockets alongside the face.
Yep. So back to it, moles eat meat, gophers eat grain and grass.
M&G, moles, meat, gophers, grain, and grass.
That's a good way to remember it. Their teeth also are a little different. The carnivore teeth like ours, will be with the moles since they eat meat. The gophers, they'll have chiseled beaver-like teeth where they go in and dig those roots out, chisel those roots out that way.
Right.
But moles will have more teeth like ours.
Right. So we've identified them. We've found out whether we have a mole or a gopher. What do we do about
them? How do we control these damn things? So that's kind of what we're after. So a couple versions. You can kind of go to the next slide. Traps will work for both of them. Labor intensive. I don't necessarily like traps because I'm not patient enough. You know, you get some folks out there that are, you know, a true gardener that likes to set the traps and wait and not necessarily stare, but just put them out there and then come back, check them every few hours. Some traps have a signal where they've been tripped,
flag a fly up
or, you know, or you just get in there and dig to see if you've tripped that trap. But gopher traps work pretty well. You know, you've got to get down in. This particular one is a spring trap where you dig a hole by that mound that we were looking at earlier, find that underground tunnel, and you actually put that trap inside that tunnel. Okay. So it takes a little bit of finagling and a little bit of getting down in there. But once you get that in there, then the idea is them to walk through that tunnel, trip that trap. Kind of like a mouse trap. Once it's tripped, it'll catch them or spear them and get them that way.
Right. So we dig the hole to put the trap in. We want to put something across that hole to keep it dark.
That's correct. So they don't think that anything's been messed with.
They don't think anything's wrong.
Yeah.
But you'll notice in the picture we've got two traps facing different directions because basically we're not sure which direction.
Don't know if they're coming in one way or the other.
Which direction they're coming from. So typically to do the best job, two traps. And just from personal experience, I kind of show it there, but tie a string or a cord to the trap and anchor it to something on top because I've lost.
Oh, because you've lost the trap.
Lost the trap because maybe it pulled through. Depending on where it got them, they're gone.
Drug it away.
Your trap is gone, and you don't know if you got them or whatever. So I've got a cinder block.
Yeah, that you tie it on.
Tie it around there, and I leave the cord kind of loose, and then I look out there and see if the cord's like
tight
to the hole.
Got something on that string.
Like somebody hit it, and then you can go out there and see if you have.
So I haven't necessarily used these particular ones. I love grain. I love poison grain to feed these guys. Basically, what you do, there's a couple different types of grain. It's usually wheat and sorghum that has the poison over, you know, coated in it.
Right.
So then you simply take a dowel rod, and then you find where that tunnel is with that dowel rod. So you start stabbing around that mound till you feel a give. And that give means that's where that tunnel or that void in that soil is. So you pull that dowel rod out, and then that grain usually has a cone on it. You cut the tip of the cone off, you dump some grain in there, and then you lightly fill that hole that you was talking where it doesn't look like that has been disturbed.
Right.
Yeah. So the grain works pretty well. I like the smaller grain better than what you call poison peanuts or poison pellets. They seem to be bigger. I mean, they work as well, but I like the small grain. It seems to be more natural for them, and they seem to get it. But poison grain works fairly well. That's my version of the way I like to control them with that poison grain.
Now we're talking about putting poison out in our yard. What about pets?
That's always a concern.
Right.
Whether that rodent consumes that, and then that, you know, bobcat or fox or dog comes in and eats that carcass.
All right.
Luckily, they're underneath the ground. So hopefully you don't have a curious dog or something like that comes in and tries to dig it up just to be safe. But that's enough grain, enough poison to kill that particular rodent, not necessarily a 20-pound dog or a 10-pound dog. But you do want to use caution if you do have animals in the backyard or you've got a lot of wildlife back there that could consume that.
So if your dog's a digger, then maybe...
Yep. And then birds as well. I mean, right. You get raptors and, you know, hawks and things that's always scouring around. But the good thing is when they do die, they die under the ground. They don't usually come up to die. So right. Usually they're hidden and we go on with it. But if you are concerned with the poison, then you want to go with the trap route. And it'll be fine. It'll be a little more labor intensive, but it can work. It can work fine as well.
So on the trap, you know you've solved the problem if you catch a gopher. On the poison, I guess you know you've solved the problem when you stop seeing mounds.
If it don't show up as much, that's right.
If it doesn't show up as much, or at least maybe it moved on to the neighbor's yard, and still a mission accomplished.
One thing on those is they are pretty territorial. Uh-huh. So, you know, you may think your backyard, which is probably, you know, 6,000, 8,000 square feet, you may only have one mole or gopher in that area. Right. They tend to fight each other off. They tend to stay in one area. Right. So that's a good thing for us, where we can go ahead and trap or kill one, and then we may not have any for a while, but then some more come in. Blame it on your neighbors.
Well, plus the pathways, the road's already there.
They're there.
The road's
there.
Already there, and they follow the road, and there's nobody here. I found a new home.
That's right. That's right. So one thing also is don't disturb that as much as possible. Try, you know, don't go out there and try to, you know, smash down all of those mounds and things. We want to keep that as undisturbed as possible until we kill them, and then we can go in and clean that up and straighten it out.
Good tips on gophers. What about moles?
So moles is similar. We have traps for moles as well, but we also have poison worms.
Like, and these I think guys, right
those
here.
Guys. So you can find that at hardware stores. You know, your local hardware stores, your local garden centers will have these poison worms. Right. Various names. Usually the ones we find at the garden centers are going to be packaged in packages of like two or three, versus a commercial brand or commercial brand that may have packages of 10, and the reason I say that is because they kind of have a shelf life. If we break that seal, open it up, they tend to lose their smell.
Or dry out
a little bit. So we want to use as fresh as possible. So, you know, if we buy a package of 10 and use three, and then they sit on our shelf for 4 to 6 months, then we may be wasting our money because they won't be as effective and they may not go to it. So keep that in mind. But these are poison worms. They contain enough poison to kill that particular rodent. This particular one's for moles. Tomcat mole killer is one that comes to mind. Commercial version is Talprid. That a lot of commercial folks will use, but these work pretty well. I think the trick on these is to find an active tunnel, an active run. You know, you'll have tunnels, they may have been there for 2 weeks, 3 weeks. The moles may not be going back through there.
They've already harvested there.
They've already gone and foraged and they're...
Because they're looking for worms and stuff
to
eat.
Feeding. Yeah. They're feeding. So one trick is to find that active one. And if we come back and see it's fresh, then we know it's pretty active, so we can treat that particular one. But if not, one of the tricks that I've done is poke a hole in that tunnel. Poke a hole in that tunnel, leave it exposed where light gets in there. Then they'll come back through and patch it. And then if they come back through and patch it, we know they're back there. So we can
active run.
Active run, so then we can go back and put that worm in there and go on. So
we say they eat worms and things. This is a bait that kind of mimics their natural food source, what they're looking for. So.
Yeah, it has that smell. Right. One other caution is wear a glove, not for poison for us, but for human scent. The human scent can get on that worm and they can kind of push it aside. Or I've even seen them push that worm back up that hole. You know they're mad.
Try again.
Yeah, ha ha, you're going to get this back up there. When that was human scent or just something they didn't like. But if you look real close, it kind of has that cutellum on an earthworm.
It looks like a worm.
It looks like worm, isn't it?
Especially in the dark.
Yeah, definitely. And it's dark down there.
In the dark in the tunnel, it's going to feel like a worm.
Yeah, I didn't think of that.
Yeah.
But yeah.
The color wouldn't matter.
Yeah, they're feeling a lot.
Well, that's right.
Eyesight's horrendous.
Yeah,
horrendous.
It would be if you were spitting
your life. But yeah, I mean, and another thing, definitely on the tunnels, you don't want to disturb those tunnels. You know, you have a tendency to go in and try to smash them down so our yard looks better. But if we're trying to control, try to leave it as undisturbed as we can. And then once we notice that we're not seeing any new ones, then we can go through there and pack it back down and go on. So just more caution. So the next slide.
Yeah, what about these
traps?
Guys?
These are harpoon traps. Right. These are mole traps. And you can kind of got to tell right there that, you know, this goes in right, kind of straddles that mound, that tunnel. And so you pull that up. It's got a spring loaded. It has a catch. So you pull it up and it catches. And then this particular latch goes right against that soil line.
Right.
And as that mole goes and pushes up that soil, it pushes that latch. Bam, spears them that way.
Right.
This is fairly easy. It's not as accurate as the gopher traps,
right.
But it can work. You know, hopefully it goes in, they spear, and it gets them that way. And they're not going to run off with this one.
Right.
So it's going to be at the ground. It's probably an 8-inch apparatus.
Right.
But it works pretty well. Again, just like our gopher traps, it's a little more labor-intensive where you'll have to go back and check. So we've got wildlife services or pesticide companies that will go out and have a mole and gopher eradication or control. Eradication's a bad word because you're never going to be able to eradicate them.
Uh-huh.
You're just going to be able to control them for a while.
Right.
So, you know, they're going to tend to do the poisons because they can set it and forget it, or they can put it in the hole and walk away. Whereas a trap, they may have to come back 24 hours later, and they've got 50 clients, and they don't necessarily have time to get back by there to reset that trap or gather that trap up. So they tend to use the poison grain and poison worms. As well. Yep. So moles and gophers is a tough one. Main thing, again, is to ID them, figure out which one you have, whether it's a mole and gopher, and then figure out how you want to treat them. And then you kind of get that plan of attack down. And then once you do that, just stay on them. You're going to be battling them throughout the year. They tend to slow down in the wintertime a little bit. They don't hibernate, but they tend to slow down a little bit.
Don't see it as much.
No. But then in springtime, they start mating, and then it really gets active because they start feeding and going. A couple interesting facts: they can tunnel 300 feet a day.
Wow.
on the moles.
Can't we all?
Tunnel 300 feet, so that's a football field.
Right.
So they're foraging. Their system, they have to eat. They have to metabolize a whole fast. They have a fast metabolism, so they have to eat their body weight during the summertime, basically every day.
Which is incredible. I'm glad we don't do that.
We'd be fat, wouldn't we? But their metabolism's so fast that they have to forage and have to go out and eat. So that's one of the reasons they can do that football field a day. And you get some nice, healthy, lush, good soil, good grass, lawns. That's perfect for them because it's harboring earthworms. It's harboring white grubs a little bit, but for the most part, the moles are eating earthworms.
Well, that's something we always hear. I must have a lot of grub worms because I've got a mole problem. Not necessarily, is what I think.
Not necessarily. I mean, you know, we have a lot of grub worms out there and they'll eat them.
Right.
But the earthworms are probably more numerous and they probably like them
a
little
better. It's not their primary diet.
Yeah. So, you know, people say, well, kill the grub worms and you'll have less moles. Yeah, and that may be the case. But any of the grub worm killers or pesticides will also kill our earthworms. Earthworms are very, very tender. They are very, you know, very susceptible to poisons.
Right.
So, I don't like to kill the grub worms to control the moles. I'd rather attack the moles themselves than what they're feeding on.
Right. Well, I know just myself, people talk about having moles. It's like, well, A, you must have good, healthy soil.
Correct.
Because if you've got moles, they're there for a reason because you've got worms in there that
correct.
Aren't going to be there eating if there's nothing there to eat.
Correct.
And then there's also with the moles, you don't necessarily have to do anything about them. They can kind of aerate the soil, loosen up the soil, unless there's a problem, unless they're really tearing up your yard, you wouldn't have to do anything. I know in my yard, I've got a few moles, and we kind of coexist.
Yeah.
We don't worry about it. If they get out of hand.
But once they get to that threshold,
yes,
and it's like, I'm going to get you.
Well, we talk about it first, and then we
you
negotiate.
You give them a chance.
We negotiate, and there's only one end to the negotiation.
Lots
of good.
But, yeah, it is. But you will have to just kind of stay on them. It's one of those that you just kind of got to be aware, and then you may kill them, and they may be gone for a couple months,
right.
Or they may show back up after a couple weeks. So, and where do they come from? Aliens bring them in, I guess. Who knows? Again,
you write that down. Aliens.
Aliens drop them in. But no, the neighbors, and you know, they've survived this long for a reason,
right.
And they'll continue to survive.
right. And I know sometimes with the moles, you'll see the mound and then it'll go to like the curb or something, and they'll be going down the curb.
Fall down that curb.
Down the curb, because avoid having to dig.
Or your house foundation. Okay. That's a great place to set that trap, because you kind of got a straight run, and you kind of know they're going to go from this part of the yard to the flower bed, and the only way they can get there is through that foundation run. So that particular one works pretty well to treat. Another damaging thing is indirect damage is from wildlife. Wildlife will go in and
digging them out, looking for
digging them. Not necessarily the moles and gophers, but they'll be digging the earthworms and the white grubs. So again, a healthy lawn brings in earthworms, brings in more wildlife. So like possums, like armadillos, like skunks. That they can kind of dig and forage for the earthworms too, and the things. So, you know, that's again a true sign of a good healthy turf is all of this activity. Not necessarily good activity for us if we're trying to keep a good lawn, but wildlife can be an issue on having extra white grubs and earthworms in there.
Right.
Yep.
Well, lots of good information there on moles and grubs. Hopefully. Yep. Be some strategies in there for people to work in their yards.
Little bit of a longer explanation, but I think it's one that's justified, because
we all battle it for the most part.
That's right.
We all face.
That's right.